Welcome to the Aspen Hot Glass Torch Shop for another marble construction adventure. I'm out here to make another Vortex marble, and of course I have ideas in my head of what I think I'm going to make, but we'll see what we actually turn up with. So let's fire up the torch and get going. Put on our glasses. I've got most of the prep stuff done that I wanted to do, but I was just going to show one little thing that as you pull out these stringers from the color rod, and you get down towards the end of the rod, I'll show you in the next piece how that works out, but we're going to cut this off with a section of the pulled out stringer. You know, this might be obvious to a lot of people, but something that I will do once in a while if I think about it. And this isn't really down to the end of the rod, but anyway, if you give yourself, if you cut it off here instead of all the way down at the very end, then that'll give you a handle to pull out from the other side. So in this instance, I've got a piece that is down to the bottom at the end of the rod. And I already was kind of working on this, and then I thought, oh, I should stop this and maybe show y'all. So now I've got a handle. Obviously the one I just did is going to be hot for a few minutes, but get yourself a little handle, and then you can pull out from there. This way you don't have to connect punty or whatever you want to call it, a handle to the other end. If you just leave yourself a handle. Well, that was a pretty messy example. Trying to show off here and that didn't really work. But anyway, you get the idea. So I'm going to use red as the base background color. Okay, maybe we can try this again. So I want a fair bit of red so that I can cover up the backside when we get to that point. Yeah, let's move on to our first construction step, which is going to be another one of these separate elements that will be the core of this marble, and I'll be putting this together and then sticking that in our little hot oven here to wait a minute until we've got the main rod ready to accept it. So I'm going to make a kind of a lopsided, twisted pane, kind of the way I would make a lot of twisted pieces. So we're going to do kind of a lopsided function where the one side of clear is pretty thick and the other side of the fume effects is relatively thin. So we start with a little tabular end here. And when you get this little step in it, sometimes you want to heat that and pull it out a little bit on that end. So you're not working with such an abrupt one-sided step. I'm going to shape this up a little more. Alright. I did a little gold recovery here. We'll see if this stick wants to fume. Yeah. So I'm going to do this one layer of gold and then trap that. So just kind of a thin covering. And all this excess gold we don't really want on there. I'm going to get this to burn off. Excuse me. And now I'll do a little silver. So this I'm going to do, just instead of covering that whole thing up, I'm just going to do some stripes. and I kind of get this melted in and ready to twist. Going to burn out that silver. I don't really want it everywhere. I want it to stay in a pattern. Grab onto one end. I could pull this off and put a handle on here, but I think I'll just keep it on this handle. So this making kind of an asymmetric pain. Come back through here and twist this some more. Condensing this back, but picking it up a little. And we can cut this off. Up center on this end a little bit. I don't think that's going to matter too much. Now hopefully this next step is going to be really kind of the main magic to this particular marble. What we're going to do now is alter the pattern by adding clear, letting that melt in, and distort the basic framework we've got so far. So what I'm going to do is lay down clear on the four quadrants. I may do this in stages. Melt that in part way. What this is doing, it's distorting just a simple spiral into four zones. It's going to be in and out. So this I want to try and maintain as just kind of a linear function and not twisted. A juggling act here because I need it to get pretty hot. Off this side. Now this end will be the end that goes onto the clear rod. So this piece is ready to set aside for right now. Move off a second. The end of our main clear rod ready. Last week's project, I kind of foolishly used some glass that I kind of suspected was going to cause some cracks. And sure enough, right in the core of the marble, we had a bunch of cracking. So that marble is going to stay on my desk for a while. So some of these sparkling colors are more favorable for deep encasement than others. Some absolutely will crack every time. And I may have actually grabbed the wrong color. Maybe it wasn't the one that I thought it was. Not really sure, but it's kind of curious to me because when I was a kid, we had our basic little marbles, and having crackle marbles was really cool. So you take your regular marbles, you stick them in the oven for a while, get them really hot, and toss them into cold water. And some of them would shatter and break, but a lot of them would just get cracks inside there, and they'd stay together. And then it was always just kind of fun to see how long could you keep playing with that marble before it really broke apart. And the other one was my grandfather owned an import business, among other things he did. And we got various import items in our household growing up, and a lot of that came out of Mexico. And one of the things we had that we really loved was some interesting, I think they're kind of a greenish colored, tall drinking glasses that were all this very fine crackle effect throughout the whole glass. Looked like it's just shattered, ready to fall apart. And we use those not as regular everyday drinking glasses, but certainly on occasions. We use those things for years and years and years. And every time you hold it, you think you've got a glass full that's just shattered. You think it's just going to fall apart. So anyway, cracking can be an interesting artistic concept. And unfortunately, much of the modern world tend to think that any kind of cracks are just a sign of a defect, something that's bad. Which in many cases, it's a fair assessment. But I think it's kind of ironic. We're talking about a piece of art. If that art is depicting chaos in the form of cracking or whatever, to me that's just another expression of art. I don't really see it as a flaw. But selling online, you have to be careful about what you put out there and what you have your name attached to. So I'll just keep it for now. Maybe I'll show it at the fair and get people interested in talking about the effects. Okay, so I've got my little central core piece that I set aside. And we're going to fuse these two together, just like bonk. And then rotate really carefully and slowly. Okay. Now today, I'm going to turn off this little heater over here, because I won't need it again for a while. A lot of times I forget and leave that thing on and it gets really hot, and then I start wondering, why is it so hot in here? Okay, so we've got this little distorted spiral going on inside here. Continue to get this to just condense back a little. So you have this pattern where some of these fume parts are all the way up to the surface and some are submerged inside there. And then it was an offset fuming effect to begin with, so you're going to have hopefully a core that you can look inside of. And then at this stage, this whole thing, I don't mind if it does get a little bit of a twist going on to it. I think that will actually add some interest. I'm kind of trying not to do that too much. So there's an element to, as it rotates, you move the marver across it to try and keep the pressure more or less without a twist. Open the window a touch more. Started out very cold and damp outside today, but I can tell it's going to get warm in here. Alright, I think we got the basics going on there. So the next phase will be add some frit backing. Do that on a piece of a multi-layer piece of foil. So, this application of frit, I want to be an open structure, kind of an open lattice. So, hopefully get our he's hot enough to pick up some frit. And now when you heat this and get the tips all glowing and come back in and add more frit, they're mostly going to stick to the frit that's already there. So this is a tricky kind of judgment call as to when it's enough. And again, as I said before, if you avoid marvering the frit, it will ball up and make dense spots rather than trying to smear it out, flatten it out. Which is kind of what I'm looking for. So after it's pretty well melted in, and we can marble a little bit. Set this down a minute. Okay, well, I wish I could see in there and see if this is working right, but we'll make something out of it. So this point right here, trying to get a good cone, trying to kind of size it up, is this kind of makes the commitment to how big this marble is going to be at the end of the session. Red is one of the crayon colors, so it's a little bit touchy. You don't want to cook it too hot. It's hard to avoid getting the base too hot. So I don't really want to smear that frit pattern. The second run is a little easier. Heat's not penetrating into the core as much. I can just kind of push into it. Okay, let's see where we're at. Using a pretty good amount of pressure. I'm going to press this red color to fill in those gaps. Very gentle on the tip. I hope everybody's doing well. Ray's down in, has been down in San Diego for a while with her grandkids and her son. She's coming home this evening. We're going to make a run up to Missoula, the airport, tonight. So it'll be good to have her back. We are a team. Okay, red or gold, or red or gold, gold or silver? Gold it is. Okay, now, over in the back. I like this red backing underneath some black, or in this case this was a turbo cobalt, I think. You get the dark glass to give you the best visual on the fume effects, and then the color from the backing. Gold and silver fuming effects look quite different on different colors, and they track with clear subsequently, and gold fume on top of red is real pretty. Yeah, it's a little small to hang on to. getting some yard cleanup and pruning going on this time of year. Got a big burn pile ready to light up maybe tomorrow. It's pretty wet out there right now, which is good. Cut down on the danger of the fire going somewhere you don't want it. People around here do quite a bit of open burning in the early season. The cut end, when it heats up, will just get real fizzy, so you want to get rid of that. Need to throw down a bunch of filler glass here. This is not to be too pretty. A lot of times people seem to think that the inside, that what you see on the inside is the same color that you see on the outside. So I'm trying to explain to them how they're kind of two separate things, separated by quite a bit of clear glass. We have, when we do live events at fair or whatever, we've got a couple of marbles that through the years have broken in two. Explainably broken in two. They didn't mysteriously break in two. But they provide a cross-section view of what's going on inside the marble. Give you those effects. Especially young kids, they seem to really like, because you can still see, even in the broken half, you can see the magnifying effect. Put the two halves together. Now we'll just let some heat and a little bit of gravity manipulation pull this together. It's becoming the back half of our marble. over here and rotate on the back side and let it condense up a little. Okay. Okay, start off with some tan. That stringer wasn't happy, but it broke at the right time at the end. Okay, then I've got a purple amber color, purple luster, I think this one is. Used this, if I have, it's been a long time. This is the blue-green glass. Used it in terms of outside the backing colors. Use this color on the inside a fair amount. Works pretty well. right on that camera. Okay, then we go for the Crazy Eddie swirl. Back on center here. touch up on the end there. Alright, time for our first punty on here. Adjustments in the alignment here. Slow sections are kind of mesmerizing as it transforms shape, and that clear rod is just kind of flowing in there very slowly, but step is always kind of want to get it over with, but I have to kind of call it at the right stage. No use in going through this much time on a marble and then getting a rush. work. Cut in a couple times, try and focus the heat on the marble side. Pull this out to thin it. And stop and cut it off where it's thin. Yes, looking good. Always come around here a second pass, but gouge out some of this clear. Cut off that colored tail so it doesn't boil up. Okay. This down. Okay, I'm going to elm over and barrel this up. Okay, we're done with that. Done with all these guys. Rough out our top clear side. That will help be kind of the template for the other half when we transfer it over. Wait for that front side to cool enough to be solid-ish.
Up.
a good size holding tank. This is just running on 4 oxygen concentrators and a holding tank. So a holding tank will let you kick it up a notch for 30 seconds or something, but it won't last forever. That kind of poked out end. And I kind of prefer that melts together on its own mostly. And we'll go back in the mold. And go all the way out to the end. Yeah, maybe. I don't want to mess up that very end. Okay, now I got the basic shape. Now this stage, actually want to get it cooled down. I want the core to solidify. If you keep the whole thing really hot at this point, you're constantly fighting it wanting to go egg-shaped or out of round somehow. Then if you just keep spinning it in the mold, the graphite is sucking up a bunch of heat. And then this heat can actually be the last fire polish sheet, I believe, on the back side. Well, these different effects can kind of be orchestrated in different assembly steps, order of assembly or different techniques, but I kind of like this idea of doing the fume core of its own, set that aside and introduce that, rather than trying to do all those effects directly off the end of the clear rod to start with. Comes up with some different things going on. So I hope you guys enjoy watching some of this stuff get put together. To me, it's always interesting to check it out towards the end when I can finally kind of assess whether what I wanted to do worked at all. But since I doubt any of you are able to read my mind as to what I thought I would see at this stage, I could look at this and say, oh, that's exactly what I wanted. It might not be very true. But it's cool. Recommendation, you heat it like that and you wait a couple seconds before you put it in the mold. Let it develop a little bit of a skin to it. That'll reduce creases and little odd malformed problems with the mold. That seemed to fill it out pretty well, so I think that done. And there's these little annoying things like this that I can see this speck of something right there. Yeah, so that kind of slows down the process. We gotta reheat and get rid of that little mess. But if I don't do that, that probably shows up as a little black speck on the face of it. And best not to just ignore something like that. So now we're going to do the high heat and let it simmer for a second. Start watching the reflections. Okay, I like it. Yeah, if any critique at this point when I'm looking in here, I'd say the silver fume I put on the initial little central piece, a little heavy on the silver, or should have used just like maybe two stripes instead of three stripes of clear. have less of that. I may think differently though after it comes out of the kiln. And then the backing colors, hopefully some of that will... There you go, now. And that will come out through the kiln cycle. That came off the way I want it to. Which is being fussy. Hissy. Boy, wow, another one. Cool marble. Glad you guys hung in there. Check out what I'm doing. Really appreciate y'all. Plop into the kiln it goes. Best to plop it down on its backside in case you get any little marks in there. Anywho, you guys all take care. Be good to yourselves, be good to everybody around you, and we'll see you again for another adventure another day. Till then, guys.